delighted that you could be with us this morning to worship the Lord together. Please stand together with me. We're going to begin by singing together our national anthem. Church would like to welcome you. Our ushers are making themselves available in the aisles, and they'd just like to give you a card. We ask that you might fill out so we can find out how we can serve you better as a church. And feel free to talk to me afterward and let me know if there's any way we can serve you as a church this morning. We do have a few announcements this morning. As you should know by this point, there will be no evening service tonight because we'll be having a fellowship meal over in Hammond Auditorium right after the morning worship service. You are invited to join us if you weren't planning on coming already. We do have extra seats available, some more food available. We would love to have you join us. If you have a free afternoon or a free lunch, we would love to have you come be with us for that. We started new Sunday school electives this morning, and I hope you had a chance to take advantage of one of those. If you haven't, I'd invite you to take your bulletins and look over the different options. We've got a good array of options. Both James and Kings, we've got books of the Bible being studied. We also have a book, What is the Gospel? An excellent book by Greg Gilbert that we taught. We also have a singles class provided. And then we have a new beginnings class, which our senior pastor, Pastor Jones, who does pastor this church, if you're just visiting with us last week and this week, and you're thinking, boy, I really would not like to listen to this guy all the time. Don't worry, next week, Lord willing, he will be back. And we await his return, and I hope you're praying for him as we are, that it would go smoothly. As an update to last week, I have not heard much from him, and that is a very good thing. So just continue to pray for him that he'll have a smooth trip and that they will have a relaxing time as a family. But back to the New Beginnings class. If you are visiting with us or you're new to our church, I would encourage you to take advantage of that class. Pastor Jones will be opening up his heart about our mission here at First Baptist Church and what we are all about as a church. And if you had a chance to be there this morning, you've heard Mike Nisus, the chairman of our deacons, open his heart about his ministry here. And if you have any questions about our Sunday school classes, be happy to answer those for you. We also have Vacation Bible School starting next week. And to tell you a little bit about that, I've invited Tim Barber, who is directing our Vacation Bible School, up here, and he's going to give an announcement about that.
All right. Next week is Vacation Bible School. And if you're not signed up, I encourage you to sign up to help right now or afterwards. And I'll be in the back hallway, find me. I'm the guy who's wearing cowboy boots and a vest. I should stand out. We need five more helpers would really, really help. And to be a helper, you need to be a member here at the church. But if you are a member and you're not signed up, we need your help. And if you are saying to yourself, well, I'm busy, I can't do that, we have things for you to do for us. You can bring in some wrapped candy. We need all the candy we can give out. It's our goal to pump all these kids full of sugar and send them back to their parents. And so we need sugar for that. So if you guys can bring any wrapped candy in, that would be a great help. Also, we need 2-liter bottles of root beer. It could be the cheap generic kind. We need as many of that as we can as well. And if any of you guys have a room in your house that's decorated with Western stuff, like you know, a chest, a trunk, all kinds of crazy Western cowboy taxidermy stuff, bring it in. Put your name on it so we know who to give it back to. And I'll be here all week from 12 to probably 6 in the gym. So just come in there and we'll use that for decorations. The kids will enjoy that. And also we'll take any and all prayers for this coming week. As kids are coming in, the gospel presentation will be given to all these kids. And hopefully some will come to know Christ through this. Thank you for your time. Look forward to seeing you there.
Thank you, Tim. And I hope that you will be either involved in participating in VBS or praying for them. I know that Tim and Alyssa Barber always put in a lot of time preparing for VBS. We're looking forward to seeing what the Lord will do through that this year. We are now going to take our morning worship offering. So our ushers will be coming forward now. And let's go ahead and look to the Lord in prayer. We receive the offering. God, we are so thankful for your many multitude of blessings to us as a church. You have so blessed us as a body here in Mishawaka and given us opportunities beyond measure to impact our community with the gospel of Jesus Christ. You have blessed us as individuals in providing for our needs, and taking care of us even in ways that we don't acknowledge. And this morning we want to give back to you out of the abundance of our hearts and what you have blessed us. We ask that you would receive this offering and bring yourself glory through it, that you would accomplish your mission both here in Mishawaka and around the world. And we ask that you would receive the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. To the end. Amen. Thank you, Kayla. Can you please stand with me as we enter into our time of worshiping the Lord through our singing. Jesus says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand." We're singing this. this morning about the security that believers have in the love of the Father. And so we say to one another an encouragement. Now, why this fear and unbelief? Sing together with joy.
Before.
So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep do not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own, and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life, that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father." So we sing together, "The Father who holds us fast in his hands, he will hold me fast."
I could never
the Lord to open our hearts for the preaching of His word this morning. Steadfast and trustworthy word to which we can cling in dark and unstable times. We thank you that you give us your spirit so that we can know your voice and have discernment to know when those who call us are not your voice and yet are wolves, those seeking to destroy your house, your church, your flock. We thank you for the multitude of promises in your word that they will never succeed. We know that your church will stand to the end of this age. We are thankful that we can cling to you and cling to your word and cling to one another as your body of believers. We're so thankful for this church, the fellowship that we have in sufferings, the joy that we share together, in blessed times. We thank you for how you work through us and through your word. We're thankful for our under shepherd, Pastor Jones. We thank you for how you protected him. We ask that you would continue to do so. You give him rest and relaxation as he is away from us, and that you would bring him back to us ready to lead and to continue in serving your body here. Father, we're going to look to your word in a few minutes. And it's not just any words on pages. These are your very words, living, alive, and powerful, able to cut us in a way that hurts, and yet surgically we understand it's going to make us who you want us to be, who you call us to be. We ask that your word would do that to us. You would teach us, you would encourage us and comfort us from your text today. We pray that you would give us ears to hear, and then give us feet to obey the truth that we have heard. In Jesus' name, amen. If you are able, would you please join me in standing one more time as we sing together, "We Hold Our God."
Thank you.
seated. As we prepare to take our deacon offering, Alex Momotu, our deacon, is going to come and pray for this offering. I'd ask that our ushers make themselves available as we take our deacon offering now together.
Let's pray. Father God, we're thankful for who you are and for what you've given to each and every one of us. Thank you for an opportunity to provide a portion that can be used to help encourage and exhort those that are struggling within our church and those outside. And I pray that you would provide wisdom and guidance to the deacons as we distribute that, and that you would bless it beyond what we could imagine, and that just it be an encouragement and a blessing to those that receive it. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Message to us this morning, would you stand with me for the reading of God's Word from Romans chapter 8, verse 31 through the close of the chapter. Follow along on the screens or in your Bibles.
What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all? How will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Pray with me, please. Father, thank you for this, for these verses that give us life and hope and assurance. And Lord, this morning, will you use your servant, Pastor Nate, to speak to our hearts, to strengthen us in our walk with you, and deepen our love for you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good
At this time, if they haven't left already, children who enter your church are free to be dismissed. Would you take your Bibles and turn to the book of Romans, please? For those of you that know me well, the book of Romans is by far my very favorite book in the entire Bible. For over 3 years on Wednesday nights, we were studying the book of Romans in our young adult Bible study before we started growth groups this summer. And we have been mining the riches of this book, and one of my very favorite parts of it, besides Romans 3, 5, 6, 7, all the other chapters, is Romans 8. I absolutely love Romans 8. And it's my joy to be able to preach from that text. Paul's letter to the Romans is all about the gospel. That's why I love it so much. If you go through each chapter bit by bit, you will see the progression of how the gospel affects mankind. If you look at the very beginning of Romans, you will see that we are not as good as we think that we are. In fact, man is totally depraved. We're in such a wretched condition. And there's nothing we can do to save ourselves. You may have noticed that in our theme of singing this morning. It's not a pretty picture, but the light is only so bright as we see it up against the canvas of how dark our own human hearts are. That's what shows the gospel to be so glorious. So when we move to the middle of chapter 3 in Romans, the scene begins to shift. As Paul writes, but God, while we were still sinners, but God changed everything. And he sent his own son to be the propitiation, meaning that his own son God put forward to absorb his own righteous wrath against mankind, so that instead of us receiving the punishment, those who put their faith in him receive his righteousness, while Jesus Christ is punished in our place. So we move to chapter 4. It illustrates how faith has always been the way that people are saved. Even in the Old Testament, things haven't changed that way. Even for the forefather of the Jews, Abraham. And then when we move to chapter 5, the theme shifts to the benefits of our salvation. What does it mean now that we are saved? Paul says that we have a new position with God. We have peace with him. We have access to him. And we have a new outlook on life since we can rejoice in our sufferings, something that seems totally strange and foreign to those who have not been saved, because we realize that through our sufferings, God can receive all the glory. The theme of salvation's benefits continues into chapter 8, where Paul describes life being controlled by the Spirit. The center of this chapter, and perhaps some of the most famous verses in the entire Bible, Romans 8, 28 to 30, deals with how we can know that God is working all things together for the good of conforming us into the image of Jesus Christ, so that as he uses all of our circumstances to make us like Christ, he brings himself the maximum amount of glory. And that is an awesome thought, perhaps the centerpiece of all of Romans. And as we move from that point, it brings us to our text today, verses 31 to 39. So as we approach your text this morning, keep in mind that Paul has been expounding to the Roman Christians all the glories and benefits of being believers. So let's pick up in verse 31. Paul writes, "What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?" Now what Paul is talking about when he says these things is not just any particular thing in general. Remember, what he's been talking about up to this point is all the benefits of our salvation, going all the way back to Romans chapter 5. So he's not just talking about a few topics, he's talking about dozens of benefits that believers have after they've trusted in Jesus Christ. So Paul says, in other words, what should be our conclusion? How are we to think and feel and act in response to knowing how God has blessed us with so many benefits as believers? So how are we to act and to feel and to think? Well, Paul responds that our conclusion can be summed up in five unanswerable questions. And from those five unanswerable questions, we derive five unshakable conclusions. So in our handout today, you'll see listed five questions and five conclusions. As we move through our text, we'll see the question, and then for each one of those questions, we'll derive one unshakable conclusion that we can take away this morning, absolutely encouraged by God's word this morning. So let's take a look at the first unanswerable question at the end of verse 31. Paul says, "If God is for us, who can be against us?" Now, Paul doesn't use the word "if" here like it's a question as to whether that's really the case or not. In other words, Paul isn't wondering if God is for us. That's already a fact that's been proven in the first eight chapters of Romans. So what is our response to all these things that God has done? Our response should be that God is for us. There's no other response that we can have when we get to this point in the book of Romans. I know we don't have the kind of luxury that we've just finished reading through it, but if you take the time to go chapter by chapter and see all the things that God promises to us as believers, the only thing you can come away with when you come to Romans 8:31 is God has to be for us. He has to be on our side. We don't need to be concerned that God doesn't have our best interest in mind when he acts. He isn't a divine bully in heaven seeking to make our lives miserable. He is for us. Today, when you look around at the world around you and you see the things going on, remember, God is for us. He's on our side. Now, notice that that leads us to another conclusion. Who can be against us? Now, we have to make sure we understand what Paul's saying here, because he's not emphasizing that if God is for us, we're not going to have any enemies. If you've been around on this planet for very long, as a saved person, you'll realize that we do have enemies, because there are enemies of Jesus Christ. In fact, Paul writes in Timothy, "Indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." So we know that just because God is for us doesn't mean that we're not going to face persecution, and it doesn't mean that we're not going to have enemies. See, you may say, what does it mean? Well, what Paul is pointing out here is that no enemy or opponent can successfully wage war against us as believers, because God is for us. The person who's on your side is far and above more powerful than your enemies, then in a sense, who can stand against us? Who can be against us? People may berate you, they may belittle you, they may even attack you, but because God is for you, there is no opposition at all in life that can have any eternal consequence. They cannot attack and destroy your soul. God holds it fast, as we just sung a few minutes ago. In fact, Chrysostom, and as we mentioned here, the first unshakable conclusion is there will be no consequential opposition. No consequential opposition. One of the early church fathers, Chrysostom, put it this way: "Yet those that be against us, so far as they are from thwarting us at all, that even without their will, they become to us the causes of crowns and procurers of countless blessings, in that God's wisdom turneth their plots unto our salvation and glory. See how really no one is against us." Isn't that an interesting way to look at it? So much as people oppose us and attack us as our enemies, they only lead us to situations of temptation and trials whereby God can receive even more glory, and we receive crowns that we can throw at his feet. Really, no one is against us. In the end, God uses those people to bring himself glory. You know, when, in our family, we have a tradition, the youngest of six. We have a tradition that when we turn 16 years old, on our 16th birthday, we go right out that day and we take our driver's test and we get our licenses. You can imagine the amount of pressure that is on the sixth child. Well, everybody else passed, so you're going to do it too, the same day. Well, I wasn't too worried because I had been driving a lot. I really was eager to start driving. You get tired of your older brothers and sisters driving around, and by the time you're the sixth one, your parents are tired of driving you around. So my mom was the most excited about me getting my license. And so on my 16th birthday, I went out and I took my test and I passed. And so that's the end, right? Driving life is perfect from then on. Well, I had a tumultuous first few years of driving. The very next day, I was going to soccer practice. My first drive out, it was fine. On the way back from soccer practice, I wanted to take my friends someplace. I don't remember where we were going. Maybe I was just taking them home. And we approached an intersection that was a little bit more busy, four lanes. And we were, of course, a cross street, so we had a stop sign, and I had to look both ways and then cross. Well, when I approached the stop sign, it looked fine. No cars to the left. There was a car to the right, but he was far enough down there. Not a big deal. I can make this. So I started to cross, but, of course, in my youthful inexperience, I misjudged how fast he was going. And as I made it about halfway through the intersection, I realized, I don't think I'm going to make it across. And in my more youthful inexperience, what did I do? I just stopped. So, as I stopped in the middle of the intersection, I just waited the impending doom as the car slowed down and still plunged right into the front of my car. So here I am, first day with my license, and I'm already in an accident. Not a very good start. Because of the nature of the accident, the officer gave us a double citation. Both of us received a citation because of that. So not only is my car beat up on the front, but I've got a traffic ticket, my first traffic ticket. And because of that, I was required to appear in court. Does this not seem intimidating to a 16-year-old? I mean, it wasn't bad enough that I got the accident. Now I've got to show up in court. I might be in jail the next 20 years of my life, all I know. So, thankfully, one of my brothers-in-law, my oldest brother-in-law, is a lawyer. And we asked him if he would maybe help me out a little bit. And we told him the story, took us into a little room before the trial. Boy, it sounds really bad. He took us into a little room and he just asked me what happened. I told him that I believed that the other driver had been speeding, and I knew it wasn't my best judgment, but I thought that was kind of the wrong thing to do too. So anyway, he said, just wait a moment. He walked into the courtroom just for a few minutes, and he came back only about 5 minutes later and said, here, come with me. And my parents and I got on the elevator and just started riding down. And I was like, where are we going? He's like, it's taken care of. I was like, what? It's taken care of? Is this that easy? Oh, this wasn't such a big deal to go to court after all. And it turns out, of course, if the other driver, which they had, admitted to speeding, then they had forfeited the right of way, and so therefore they took away my traffic ticket for that reason. Not to say that that taught me much, because in the next few years I accumulated a couple more. But those are different stories for another time. The point of the story is to say how much better I felt when I knew that somebody was for me. Going into the courtroom, as a 16-year-old, I was a little scared. But to know that there was somebody who knew what he was doing, who understood the law, who knew how to take care of it, was on my side, comforted me immensely. How do you think we should feel as believers knowing that God is for us? The one who knows the end from the beginning, who knows all things, who controls all things, who sets up all things. To know that he is for us leads to an unshakable conclusion. If God is for us, who can be against us? No consequential opposition in our lives. When Paul says that God is for us, conveniently, as with my illustration, he begins to use the language of a courtroom. In the legal battle for our eternal destiny, God is on our side. And he proves that he is on our side with the next unanswerable question in verse 32. He says, he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? That is the second unanswerable question. Now, most English translations don't fully bring out the emphasis in this verse that I feel like Paul is trying to make. It's not just that he didn't spare his own son. There's a little two-letter Greek word here that stresses that he didn't even spare his own son. Meaning that Jesus is God's precious and only son, and for God to give him up would be the greatest sacrifice above all other sacrifices. So God being for us has its deepest demonstration in his giving his own son for us. This is a demonstration that should lead us to no doubt believe that he is for us. In fact, if he gives up his greatest resource, his greatest treasure, his own son, it would be inconceivable to think that he would withhold anything else for us. I mean, how will he not with his son freely give us all things? He's already given us his most valuable resource, his most valuable treasure. No, God didn't hold back his son. Instead, he delivered him over. You look throughout the New Testament, that's the very words that are often used to describe Jesus' crucifixion. He was delivered over for us. God proved that he's for us by not sparing his own son, and that leads Paul to conclude that he will also give us all things. Now, what is Paul talking about when he says all things? Is he talking about money? A new Mercedes? Is he talking about a new job? I mean, what is Paul talking about with all things? Well, remember the context that Paul is addressing. He began the section by asking, what shall we say in response to these things? So I believe he's talking about the very same things, which are the benefits of our salvation, the very things that God has promised to us as believers. So how shall he not also give us all these things? He's saying, look, if God has given us his only son, he for sure is going to give you all of those benefits that we've already talked about all these past chapters. Don't worry. God has not overpromised and underdelivered. He's going to give us every single one of those. If he's given his own son, he's going to give us all these things. Second unshakable conclusion for believers is no deprivation of any necessary thing. If God wouldn't even spare his own son, he most certainly won't hold back his spirit. He won't restrict us from the access we have to the Father in prayer. He won't neglect to comfort us in our afflictions. He won't ignore us when we cry to him. He won't fail to provide the way of escape in temptation. And he most certainly will use all of our circumstances to work out the ultimate good, that we are conformed to Christ and he will receive the glory. God won't hold back from you anything that you need. He says in 2 Peter 1:3, his divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us to his own glory and excellence. Remember, moms, when you're tempted to think you don't have everything you need to be a good parent, God won't deprive you. He will most certainly give you everything you need to be the kind of mom that your kids need. Remember, addict, when you're tempted to believe that you'll never break the chains of your addiction, God won't deprive you. He didn't even hold back his own son for you. He will surely, along with his son, give you what you need to conquer your addiction. God proved that he is for us when he sent his son to die for us, but Paul continues to show that God is for us in the legal battle for our eternal destiny. Look at verse 33 for the third unanswerable question. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. The first thing we need to notice about this verse is that Paul is asking about a future event. Who will bring an accusation against God's elect? Remember that in the last day, everybody is going to be judged. And Paul wants to know who will approach the bar on that judgment day and will stand against God's elect and raise an accusation against them. Now, it's important for us to realize that many may seek to accuse us. Satan, for sure, who has already accused Job, as we've read about in the Old Testament, he may choose to accuse us. Certainly, many of our enemies may accuse us. And most powerfully of all, our own sins will shout in God's highest court as they lay a charge of blame against us before the Holy One. But none of those accusations will stick. And none of them will matter. Why? Because God is the one who is justifying. He is the one who is declaring people to be righteous, and since he is the highest judge, his ruling is the only one that matters. If he declares us to be righteous, then we are righteous regardless of what Satan, regardless of what our enemies, and regardless of what our own consciences tell us. God's ruling is the only one that matters. So how can we be sure that God will not lay a charge against us? Why won't he accuse us? After all, he is just. He knows all things. Well, notice the word that Paul uses to describe us here. He says, who shall bring any charge against God's elect? Now, maybe you're thinking, why would he use the word elect here? Why not say, who shall bring any charge against those who believe in Jesus? That's talking about us as well. Or why doesn't he say, who shall bring any charge against the saved? Why does he use the word elect? Well, you may know the word elect means to choose. So the focus here is on the fact that we were chosen by God and we didn't choose him. His salvation is based on his own perfect will and not our fickle and changeable natures. So as believers, we don't have to worry and sit and think that somehow our sins are going to send us out of heaven. That somehow if we just do the one next step that's worse, that's it. We've lost our salvation. There's nothing we can do. No, it's not going to happen because our salvation has never been dependent on us. It has always been dependent on God. The issue is not what I have done, but what God has done. No one can bring a charge against God's elect because he has chosen them. And they will most certainly be glorified as he promised in verses 28 to 30. All whom God chooses, he will glorify. So if God declares you to be righteous, who cares what Satan, what your enemies, or your conscience says? The third unshakable conclusion is no accusations entertained. There will be no accusations entertained before the just judge of the universe. You know, perhaps there's someone here that really struggles with doubts concerning whether God can use you because you feel like you've been too sinful. You think that your sinful past renders you unavailable for God to use. I think there's just no way that a perfect God could use somebody as sinful as you to accomplish his will. I want to ask you to remember a stanza of a song that we sing here frequently. When Satan tempts me to despair, and he tells me of the guilt within, what do? Upward I look, and I see him there who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God, the just one, the just and the justifier, is satisfied to look on him and to pardon me. Who cares what our conscience says to us? Who cares what others say about us? No accusations entertained, because the just judge of the universe has chosen us. What security! We are safe in God's love. The next unanswerable question we see is built upon the previous one. Let's look at verse 34. Paul writes, "Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, and more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us." Condemnation is the opposite of justification. So whereas God will declare somebody righteous who has trusted in him, condemnation instead is somebody who prosecutes and sentences you justly to eternal separation from God and therefore punishment. 2 Timothy 4:1 tells us that Jesus is the one who will judge the living and the dead, so he has the right to condemn. However, this verse tells us that Jesus, the one who is going to judge and who has that right to condemn us, was raised and is at the right hand of God. And what is he doing for us right now? He's interceding for us. So let me ask you something. If somebody's interceding for you in a courtroom, does that sound like a prosecuting attorney? Does that sound like somebody who's out to get you? It's actually the opposite. We're talking about somebody who stands in your defense. We're talking about somebody who is standing before the just judge and saying, "I have covered it. This person is free." We don't have to worry that Jesus is going to condemn us, even though he has the right to do so, because instead he's doing the very opposite. He is speaking on our behalf. What comfort that brings us today to know just judge of the universe, Jesus Christ, is on your side, and he is speaking for you. He is interceding for you. So, the fourth unshakable conclusion is there is no final condemnation. Yes, again, just like accusations, your own conscience may try to condemn you. Other people may try to condemn you. But the only one who can sentence you to final condemnation is the very one who is interceding on your behalf. Many of you probably listen to, as I've talked to you, I know that is the case. Many of you have listened to Dave Ramsey before. Anytime somebody asks him how he's doing, what's his response? "Better than I deserve." That's a really deep response, actually, because as believers, that's always the case. Actually, as unbelievers, it's the case too. Because what we deserve is eternal punishment in hell for all eternity. We saw that in the beginning of Romans. That's exactly what we deserve immediately. Yet Romans also says that God is putting off that punishment for many so that they will trust in him. For some of you today, that may be what he's doing for you. He's putting off that eternal punishment because he's giving you a chance to turn, to repent. For believers, we're better than we deserve because we deserve the very same thing, and yet we know what we're going to receive is Jesus' righteousness. We're going to be with God forever. Not because we deserve it, but because he has given us exactly what we don't deserve, and that is mercy. Well, the last unanswerable question leads us away from the courtroom into a more personal emphasis. Look at verse 35. Paul writes, "Who shall separate us from the love of Christ?" Now, when Paul refers to the love of Christ, he's talking about Christ's love for us rather than our love for him. The reason I make that distinction is because we as sinful people, even though God loves us, we don't always perfectly love him. That is not stable. We're shaky people. But as far as Christ's love for us is concerned, Paul is asking, who can separate us from Christ loving us? And notice the word he uses here for separate. That word actually is the word charizo. It's the same word used in the New Testament to talk about divorce. This is a really painful reminder that even the closest earthly relationships can be divided. Because we often experience disappointment in our human experiences, we often project the possibility of those experiences into our relationship with God. In other words, when we see failures in our relationships with spouses or failures in our relationship with our parents, we often take those failures and we see them as relationships and we project them and say, maybe God could do that too. For example, perhaps you've had a spouse leave you before. You may think God probably could do that too. Or maybe if a husband has abandoned you in the right circumstances, God may leave you high and dry as well. The comfort to this is that God is not subject to the flaws of earthly relationships. So when Paul says, "Who shall separate us from Christ's love for us?" he lists seven notorious dividers in verse 35. Let's look at that. This is a really important verse. He says, "Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or even the sword?" Let's take those for a second here. Tribulation, when he uses this word, it's a frequent word in the New Testament. He's talking about a pressure that bursts things. Think about somebody having their thumb down and just kind of squishing you. Do you ever have a circumstance in life where you just kind of feel like you're being squished? Like the juice is just being pushed right out of you? Is that an indication that God's posture towards you has changed? And somehow Christ doesn't love you anymore because you're going through that tribulation? How about distress? We talk about that in the New Testament. We're talking about a narrow place where you're hemmed in from all sides and all alone. Think about those who are separated from family, from friends, those who love you. You just feel like you're being surrounded on all sides by people who don't care for you. If that's the case in your life, is that an indication that Christ doesn't love you anymore? What about persecution? These people that Paul is writing to in Rome would face 3 centuries of Roman persecution following this letter. I think Paul was getting ready for that. When that happens, believers, does that mean God's abandoned you? You say, that doesn't happen now. I don't know what that feels like. Well, maybe we're receiving this letter the exact same way that these Roman Christians did. Maybe we don't have it now, but what if the next 10 years, the next 20 years, what if the next several decades we start to face persecution? Ask yourself, is that an indication that Christ has abandoned us? He doesn't love us anymore. Paul talks about famine. They faced frequent scarcity of food. What about nakedness? He's talking about believers who have persecution come to their very doorstep. And they come in and literally tear the very clothes off of you that you're wearing so that you have none. If that happens to you, does that mean that Christ has abandoned you? Danger. This is a powerful one. This is actually the only other place in the New Testament that this word is used, is in 2 Corinthians 11:26. I've got it for us here. I want you to read it. This is Paul. So if you think he's talking just out there in a cloud, something he's never experienced himself. This is Paul talking about his own experience, his own testimony. He says, on frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, danger from robbers, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers. 8 times Paul uses this word danger to describe different kinds of possible dangers. Do you think Paul knew what he was talking about? Paul had faced some dangers. At least 8 different kinds in this verse, kinds that we've never experienced. And Paul says, when you face these things, does that mean that Jesus doesn't love you anymore? Does that mean that he's abandoned you? The last one in this verse, the sword. It's metonymy or synecdoche for death itself, something Paul had not yet faced, but you know, he was certain to face it very soon. Paul wasn't totally foreign to the concept. If it comes all the way to you being killed, does that mean that Christ let go of you? He doesn't love you anymore. These are some tremendously powerful and notorious dividers. But rather than answering the question, Paul first quotes Psalm 44:22. If you look at the next verse, he says, "For your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered." And you may say, wow, that quotation from the Old Testament seems like a pretty strange interruption for Paul to make. But he uses it to make a very important point for us. Paul is saying that just as it was common for the godly to be persecuted in the psalmist's day, so it should come as no surprise that believers will be exposed to the tyranny of the wicked today. And believers here this morning, in the year 2015, this should be just as true to us today as it was to Paul's audience then. Look, if you think it's strange that we're going to be persecuted for being believers, erase that from your minds, because it's been happening all throughout the ages. Those who love God have always been slaughtered, have always been persecuted. Persecution should not surprise Christians. It should seem normal. But in spite of this fact, in spite of the fact that we've got all these different things that could potentially persecute us, and Paul says actually they will, in spite of these possibilities and certainties, will they separate us from Christ loving us? And the answer, of course, is in verse 37. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And you may ask, how can we overwhelmingly conquer or be more than conquerors when we face tribulations and persecutions and famines and dangers and the like? And it goes back to that truth, Romans 8:28 through 30. And that is that all of these things, God uses the very things in our lives that would seem to crush us in order to mold us into the image of his Son, thereby bringing God all the glory. So you say, how do we conquer through tribulations and through all these notorious dividers? God uses them to make us like Christ, and he brings himself glory so that the very things we think are going to crush us are the things that God uses to exalt us. That's an incredible promise. An incredible encouragement. And Paul closes us here with a confident assurance of the facts that he's made. Look at the last couple verses. He says, "For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord." So whether you're dead or alive, your state of existence can't separate you from Christ's love for you. Neither God's glorious messengers, the angels, or Satan's evil minions can separate you from Christ's love for you. The things happening right now in your life, nope, they can't separate you from Christ's love. Those things that could happen and will happen in the future, those can't do it either. Though somebody be the most powerful ruler in the world, the government, and though they may mock God, and though they may mock His will, they can't separate you from Christ's love for you. No distance can separate you from God's love for you. And in case Paul missed anything, he throws in the all-encompassing, nor anything else in all creation, which means that not even you can separate you from Christ's love. So the final unshakable conclusion for believers is that for us, there will be no separation from Christ's love for us. Do you believe you're safe in God's love? Are you absolutely convinced that God is for you and that He will never allow anything, not even you, to separate you from Christ's love for you? Maybe right now you're going through one or more of those notorious dividers that Paul talks about. Maybe some kind of tribulation. Maybe some kind of pressure. You feel like it's squeezing the life right out of you. Remember that God has told us that these things will most assuredly happen to believers, and they are no indication that you will be separated from Christ's love. No, Jesus is using that trial for your good and for His glory. What unbelievable safety to hold these unshakable conclusions. That as believers, we face no consequential opposition, no deprivation of any necessary thing. There will be no accusations entertained. There will be no final condemnation, and there will never be any separation. We are safe. Let's pray together. Father, we are so thankful that You have given to us Your mighty, powerful, and many promises. Not just in Romans, but throughout Your Word. We thank You that we have access to them through Your Spirit who lives within us. You can remind us of these promises when we face these dividers, these persecutions, the tribulations. I pray, Father, that You would so soak Your Word in us so that we can claim these promises when we need them most. When we are tempted most to despair of our own sinfulness, or to despair that perhaps we have been separated from Your love. Maybe You don't love us anymore. Father, would You remind us through Your Spirit that You do love us, that You care for us, that You're intimately involved in what's going on in our lives. Father, help us to be thankful for this blessed condition that we have, these unshakable conclusions that we have in response to the glorious promises You've made to us. In Jesus' name. If you're able, I would ask you to stand with me and sing together a song of thanks to Jesus, the one who has given us these unshakable conclusions. Jesus, thank You.
Perfect Holy One from
Common Auditorium. If you don't have any plans, we would love to have you join us over there for that time of fellowship. We're going to continue to pray for the Joneses as they finish up their vacation this week, in the middle of the week. We also want to pray for Anna Long, Cody's wife, who is in labor right now, has been in labor since Friday evening. And so we want to pray for her that that would go smoothly today. Let's pray together. Father, what a blessing it is to know your Son, Jesus Christ, and to thank him, to thank you for all that you have done for us. We pray that you would have your blessing upon the food that we eat here in a few minutes. We ask that you would strengthen us through it, and most importantly, through the fellowship time that we have together as believers. We thank you that we are unshakably fixed upon Jesus Christ and his promises for us. Please help us as we leave this morning to be convinced of them, to hold tightly to them this week, as we seek to be lighthouses in your community here at Mishawaka. We pray, Father, for Pastor Pete and for Bethany and for their kids, that you would give them safety, continue to refresh them, help them to return to us safely this week. We pray for Anna, and we lift her up to you and ask that you continue to work. We know that you are aware of her and what she is going through. We ask that you would strengthen her and encourage her, be with Cody. Pray that you would confirm your promises to them, and we pray according to your will that she would be able to deliver this baby safely today. And we ask that you would dismiss us with your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.